tapfer und gläubig, fröhlich und frisch kämpfen sie auch für dich. Leben im Wald unter Bäumen und Steinen, in ihren Höhlen, da sind sie zu Haus.
Gummibären hüpfen hier und dort und überall. Sie sind für dich da, wenn du sie brauchst. Das sind die Gummibären.
Alright, we're on.
Yeah, well, we're on now, and all the listeners missed Fred's sort of, it sounded like an Irish old man impression. And
yeah, I don't know what that was.
It sounded like maybe an Italian old man.
My hands, the arthritis, it hurts.
My hands do hurt. I don't know, I might have arthritis in my hands at age 30, and I'm falling apart.
Too much guitar.
I do have arthritis in my hands at age 40, so there you go.
I think I have it in my hands and my foot and in my neck, and yeah, it's a lot of fun being 30. I'm having a great time.
Wait till you get to 40.
I don't think I'm going to make it. I was going to be quite honest. I'm not going to make it.
I wonder how this album feels, too. It's on your born year it was released.
Yeah, it's the same age.
Oh, God.
And besides that, I guess...
What's it called? The jewel case is cracking. There's no teeth on to hold the CD anymore.
Yeah. The fucking teeth.
The booklet's ripped.
Yeah, I was gonna say I lost, or I didn't gain any metal points this weekend. There were three big shows, and I didn't go to any of them, probably because I'm just lazy and I forgot, and maybe I don't care. Yeah. I'm really sounding enthused on this episode, aren't I? I'm like, I'm old, everything hurts, I didn't go to any of the shows, and I don't care. And
well, what show did you not go to?
Let's see, who played this weekend? From Friday through Sunday, there were shows. I was going to go to the Friday show, but sold out, and I waited too long. That was Autopsy and Repulsion. I'd seen them before, but I felt like maybe I should go. But there, I saw the videos too. There's a million fucking people there. That's kind of, I'm kind of okay with missing that.
Yeah, I wasn't too pressed on going to that one.
Yeah, I'm not too pressed about it.
Man, if Autopsy and Repulsion played over here, I'd be fucking all over that.
Oh yeah, you should be. Had you ever seen either of those bands?
Nope.
Damn.
Yeah, I think I'd seen Repulsion three times. Autopsy once, but it was quite a while ago. But
just taking them for granted.
yeah, a little bit. Because they played earlier this year, too.
Yeah.
Over here. They're always playing over here.
Man, what a world you guys live in. Autopsy's playing. Ugh, again.
I know. You know who else played over here, too? Mortis. And,
oh, yeah.
There was a big festival this weekend.
Oh, yeah, the Excruciation Fest. Yeah,
I didn't hear a lot of people talking about that.
Yeah, that was just like the Brutal Death Metal Fest. They had like Epicardectomy on Saturday. That was like the only band that I kind of was down to see. The rest were kind of like, man, it's like one of those like...
The Awesome Wiggers?
Yeah, it was just like full day kind of show, and I'm like, I don't know if I want to show up at like fucking 11 and pay like $40 to see one band.
Yeah, and then get the fuck out, and then like just and then when you're waiting for the band, you're just kind of sitting there.
Yeah.
Like who you talk to, Sparky?
No, apparently he's like in the hospital. He has like he sent a selfie that Friday or Saturday on Instagram on his story, and he just had like a neck brace.
Oh my.
We're just like, damn, what happened to him?
Did he do that at a show? Because he's always going a little bit too wild and getting beat up.
Yeah, I don't know. But, yeah, so I know, like, Julian and Co went. So, I was like, not really feeling it. But apparently, go ahead.
I was going to say, there was another one that day, like a big show, not just the Brutal Death Metal one, like the same exact day, Mortis was up there on stage by himself doing the Dungeon Synth thing, and
I saw Mortis live. He was great.
Oh, did you? Yeah. Deathside played, the Japanese band Excel. It seemed like it was a weird kind of lineup. It was a lot of like thrash core and the like crust core kind of stuff, and then Mortis thrown in there.
Huh. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Who was headlining?
Mortis.
I have no idea. Mortis maybe.
Oh, wow.
I don't know.
That's weird to have like a bunch of metal bands and then ambient.
Had to set, cool it down at the end.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then.
No, like, there's a couple shows I didn't go to. Deicide.
Talk about the shows we didn't go to.
Yeah, seriously. Deicide and Christian played on Sunday. I didn't wind up going. Was that last week? That was the week before, wasn't it? Oh, I didn't go to that. And this past Saturday, Sedimentum and Copperlith played. And I was like, I'm just going to stay home.
Yeah, we'll make up for it on in two weeks. Yeah, yeah, we got Sabbat.
Oh, jealous. No, next show I think I'll go to is Morbid Romance and Nachtlich in late October. Oh, why is Sabbat not playing Canada? Fucking sucks.
Well, then, when we see him, we'll make a request.
Hey, can you make a trip over to...
Yeah, our friend Fred would really appreciate it. You know, thanks, guys.
We'll pull up
the picture. When they played Montreal...
We'll pull up the picture.
Be like, hey, remember this guy?
Hey, yeah. Remember this guy?
When they play, tell them that instead of playing Black Fire, tell them to play Feu Noir, the French version they played when they played in Montreal.
Let's have them play Black Fredward.
Black Fredward. Black Fred with Black Fred, Black Fred.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, I don't know how I feel about this show coming up on Sunday. It's Lividity and Guttalax.
I saw that. I saw the flyer.
Yeah.
I would not go.
You would not go to Lividity and Guttalax?
No, but that's not surprising. Brutal Death.
I feel I would be kind of interested in seeing Guttalax.
Here's the thing. Most of the shows I go to are like an hour drive to get downtown. If it was not an hour drive, I would probably go. But for an hour drive, I'm like, ugh, no, can't be bothered.
Yeah, I don't know I don't know what it's like for other people, but yes, there are a lot of shows in LA. And I think what most people do is take Ubers, and I think I'm going to start doing that because, number one, I just hate driving through that place because it's such a fucking shithole. And then there's nowhere to park. So it's like double suck.
And when you find somewhere to park, it's like you gotta pay up the ass.
Yeah. And you gotta walk far to get to the venue because there's no parking.
Yeah, drop me off right in front.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna start doing that. I think I'm done driving through that area and parking in that shit bum infested shithole. I think I'm about done with that shit.
Let's try it out on next Friday.
Yeah. I can get an Uber to your house, and then yeah, we can get an Uber to LA. Then we can trade a couple Ubers more, and you know it's gonna cost, but I think it's worth it.
Mhm.
Yeah. And then Nunslaughter played last night, and I don't know. I just I was tired. I didn't want to go. I didn't care.
Oh, too many shows.
Too many shows and not enough bros.
Yeah.
Not enough bros to go to the shows.
No comment.
But even if there were, I would probably go. I'm good. Just because I'm a lazy fuck.
Yeah, that's where I'm at these days. Lazy fuck status.
Yeah, what's her name? The vocalist of Harlequin was working at that brutal death metal show. And then she came over to Drew's after, and we were, I met her. She was actually really cool.
Yeah, I think she's, like, married to one of the dudes that runs that fest, because he's in, Stages of Decomposition, and then...
I think it's the sister.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, yeah.
When you say he's in Stages of Decomposition, it just sounds like he's dead.
Like he's a corpse.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I think she got me into the Future Pile.
Yeah, yeah. So I, you know, we were hanging out and having some beers, and I think the week before that I was the two guys from that Devouring Rot, the Skeletal Remains like post band. Met those guys too. I've been making more contacts at Drew's Bully Barn than actually going to shows. So that kind of works. It's like right around the corner. Easy peasy, just hang out. we're still listening to metal. I'm just not spending money, and well, I'm spending money, but you know, I don't know. There's I like the show atmosphere sometimes, but sometimes just kind of standing around for long periods of time makes me it makes me dread anything.
Remember when we started the show, we were like, haven't been to shows in like a long time, or they'd be like so sparse, and then now it's like fucking almost once a month.
Almost every weekend.
Yeah.
So I don't know. It's like, what am I supposed to be like? I gotta go to a show because we do a metal show and I need cred to do a show. And no, how about no? How about fuck no? How about I'll do what I want? I'll sit in the AC. How about that?
Gotta play a show though. Yep.
Yeah, I'm down to play some shows.
Audience, don't be like us. Go to shows. Go to our shows.
don't be like us. You don't want to be anything like us.
You want to like us, but don't be like us.
Yeah. It's cool. Like, we're cool guys, but, you know.
Show up, buy merch, go home.
Yeah, exactly. Well.
Yeah, I was going to say, J-Dog finally got that Deicide interview.
Oh, yeah, I saw part of that.
Yeah, fucking Glenn didn't duck the dog this time.
Didn't duck the dog. That's correct.
And he got the Steve Asheim, too.
He got what?
The Steve Asheim interview, too.
Who's that?
The drummer of Deicide.
Oh, okay. I didn't see that.
I saw the part where Glenn was describing Euronymous. Like, yeah, Halloween. Like plastic Halloween cape. Yeah.
That was true. I wonder if Glenn really didn't care for Euronymous.
I don't know. Like, there was a bit of a weird relationship between Euronymous and American death metal. I think he took a lot of influence from them musically, but he didn't like the fact that they were not dressing up in corpse paint and armor. And he's like, but Deicide used to, right? So maybe he was alright, okay with them, but like, it's like, why are these bands going on in jeans and sweatpants? And it's like, who cares?
I don't. The way I think of it is like, doesn't everybody do that? If that's the, you know, what, everybody has to dress exactly the same on stage? You need spikes, you need pants, you need
it's like, whoa, this guy's, no. Whoa, this guy's
I'm wearing my Star Wars pajamas right now, so fuck y'all.
Very Reddit of you.
Yes, I have pants that are just covered in Darth Vader faces, and the t-shirt is Darth Vader swinging his lightsaber, and I feel cool. Very adult right now.
Yeah. That's another very Reddit joke. I'm adulting.
Adulting, not culting.
I'm looking at this J-Dog video title. It says, Deicide butt-raped by Chicago promoter on tour.
That's one way to phrase it.
Yeah, he's got interesting titles here.
I like the live video of Deicide, what he titled that one. Let me see if I can find it. This shit's... along those lines, he's like butt raping fucking twin core bands. It's just like a Deicide life.
It says Deicide defecating all over wimpy twin core posers.
It's just like defecating. A live set.
It's funny that you think that J-Dog like thinks of this and just like types it out. Deicide defecating.
He just says like speech to text.
Yeah.
Women throwing themselves at serial killers.
Well, I have very few updates in terms of my collection this week. I have one new CD, Tysinum?
Dark and Black.
Yeah. A la Porta di Centur, something like that.
Let me see if I can pretty, get anybody.
It's pretty cool. It's like melodic medieval black metal, but like doesn't use shitty folk instruments.
Shitty folk instruments. I'll check it out. It's in my my list here.
Like their riffs are folky. They don't use folk instruments to beat over the head with it.
All right, yeah, I'll check it out. I have. If there's anything I can recommend to people, Fred, you ever heard of a band called Paprava?
I think they're from. Yeah, China. I have their split with Dark Fury.
Oh, yeah. I think it's members of Dark Fury is what it is.
I think so, yeah.
Or live members or some shit like that.
There's some relation there. I don't remember what it is, but...
Yeah, I found them on a split with Raven Dark's Monarchal Canticle, and I thought they were pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
They sort of remind me of the Brazilian stuff, too.
Yeah, it almost like sounds what? Like Command or Command Evil, that sort of thing?
Not really. No, I meant like the Cogumelo stuff is what it sounds more like. It doesn't really have the like second wave sound.
Oh yeah, it's been a while since I listened to the split. I didn't know they had an album come out, and that came out last year.
Yeah, I went ahead and bought that one. I saw it wasn't on YouTube, so it'll be uploaded on the channel sooner or later, whenever I get the CD.
Yeah, no, I'm interested to hear that. Well, you sent a link to it, didn't you? Or is it just the...
I sent the link. There was one song on there, one promo.
Okay. Well, that's better than nothing.
Yeah. I think no, they were just talking about...
The split was good. Dark Fury is an underrated band, though. Like, everything they... Dark Fury is kind of like Clandestine Blaze. Like, everything they do is just fucking solid. It's like no frills black metal, just good.
In that sense, it is very Polish. I feel like the Polish scene doesn't really have a lot of, like, eccentricities. They're kind of just pretty straightforward. Sometimes I like that idea. I checked out a little bit of Dark Fury this weekend. I thought it was pretty solid. Nothing too special, but cool enough.
Yeah, W.A.R. and Sinning Thwaite, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, are my favorites. Flooded Lands was pretty good, too.
But yeah, I ended up listening to the Berserker album today too, which is actually quite good. More dynamic than people would think. No Berserker for you, Fred, I imagine, right?
I have not heard it, no.
Oh, no?
Nope.
I think you could probably dig it. It's got a weird kind of like dancey drum machine thing, but there's like some brutal death. Ooh. And like melodic death kind of behind that.
I smell a picka coming.
Ooh.
The Berserker?
Maybe.
Maybe. Maybe.
Maybe. Maybe.
Make Fred listen to it.
Hey, I will give everything a listen. I might complain about it later on, but I'll listen to anything.
Yeah, Joe recommended that Dark Throne album. Like, what is it called? Ravishing Grimness? I had never heard it before, but... it's solid, and I see why he likes it.
I think that one's kind of overlooked a bit. It's
it is. I never hear anybody mention this ever.
The problem I found was, and I've said this a million times, but like total death is where things started going wrong for Dark Throne. Not going wrong. The way I always describe it is Total Death is where Dark Throne started sounding like Dark Throne rather than being Dark Throne. They just started retreading their own path at that point. So Total Death didn't do much for me, but Ravishing Grimness, it's not nowhere near the level of the Unholy Four, because Panzerfaust is just as good as the other ones. I'll fight anyone who says otherwise.
I didn't like Panzerfaust that much.
Okay, so I'm going to have to fight you, obviously.
Yeah.
But...
I thought it was too Celtic Frost.
It was very Celtic Frost, but that's what I like about it.
That's what I don't know.
But Ravishing Grimness was just very straightforward, and it kind of got... Like, from what I remember when it...
It's basically Black Thrash, like, through the lens of black metal. It's
yeah, cool. Kind of.
It's cool that way. I like it.
Because, like, when I was getting into them... Plague Wielder had just been released, and I remember that was at the time being touted as a big improvement over Ravishing Grimness. But ultimately, I like Ravishing Grimness more than Plague Wielder. It was weird because they had like a series of albums where they just had like something, I put in quotations, unique about them. Like Total Death had all the different people contributing to the lyrics. Ravishing Grimness was them using better production. Plague Wielder was a color album cover. And
I've never heard like, Plague Wielder.
It has some decent songs on it. Like, I don't hate anything Darkthrone did up to and including Sardonic Wrath. And I actually think Hate Them and Sardonic Wrath were huge upswings for them. Hate Them is one of my favorite from them. Plague Wielder, I think, is, along with Total Death, probably the weakest of the good albums, if that makes any sense. But Sin Origin, Reigning Murder, and Reek are good songs on there. Then they started going the kind of crust punky thing with Cult is Alive, and that's where they kind of lost me. So,
never heard Sardonic Wrath either.
You know, their Hate Them and Sardonic Wrath are just fucking great albums. Like, there's nothing I dislike about them. They're not on the level of the classics, but they're solid 80% albums. They get A marks from me.
I heard Dark Thrones and Black Flags.
Why would you do that, that to yourself?
I like that one.
Yeah, I found this stuff after that came out after Sardonic Wrath. Each album had at least a few tracks I liked.
Yeah. Well, same here. I liked most of them, maybe not every single one.
Hmm. But I kind of, the Underground Resistance was kind of where I tuned out. So like, I've heard bits and pieces of like the albums after that. Like, I don't remember all of them, but like Arctic Thunder two. And
I totally tuned out at Arctic Thunder. Track two of Underground Resistance, Valkyrie. That's a really good song.
I think the problem I had with Underground Resistance isn't that it was a bad album so much as it's just not what I want to hear from Darkthrone.
It doesn't sound like Darkthrone.
No, and that's the thing, and that's probably just like a limited view on my part, but like when I see the Darkthrone logo, I kind of expect to hear something that lines up with the first, what, 7-8 albums? Except Soulside.
Land of Frost demo.
Yeah, but so when I listen to Underground Resistance, I'm like, yeah, I like this. I'm enjoying it. It's just not what I was hoping to hear from Darkthrone. And so I just kind of went elsewhere for my Darkthrone fix and kind of just stopped paying attention. And they've like really, really started like flogging their old material. Like reissuing the instrumental version of Goat Lord. Like, did that really need its own independent release?
Are you a fan of Old Wayne's at all? I don't think I've ever heard you mention them.
So I have a bit of a weird relationship with them. I have one album that is okay, but I'm not a huge fan of it. But I've also been told that's one of their weakest, so I should probably revisit.
Which one? Scalding Coldness?
No, I don't think so. Oh. I don't know what it's called in English. It's one with the Burning Church on the front.
Oh, okay. I skipped that one. I went straight to the 2005 album for the my listening enjoyment. It's pretty good.
Religion of Spiritual Violence. That's the one I have.
Mm.
But that album's getting 290% scores on Metal Archives. Maybe I should just revisit it. But yeah, I saw you sending Well, the new one.
I think Paul sent the new track, and that kind of made me realize I haven't really sat down and listened to a full old Wayne's album, so I'll do so.
Mm.
Solid.
Probably I'll could use some revisit the one I have, I guess, and see if that clicks. I don't know why, but I like randomly pulled out Ross Omahar a while ago.
Ross Omahar? Is that the one with the dragon on it, or is that something else?
Yeah, no, it's the one, Imperium Tenebrarum, the first album from whatever the fuck year.
Yeah.
I think Horna used that cover as well. It's like a Lord of the Rings illustration. But, that's a solid album. Doesn't get much mention.
Paul, do you want to tell the listeners about something that they don't care about?
Yes.
What's that? Do you want to tell them about Little Vince? We all left his group chat.
Oh yeah, so we were just fed up with it Thursday. We're like, oh no. So it starts off Wednesday. No. Tuesday.
How does it start off?
God, get your story straight.
What exactly happens that's pissing you off?
It starts off Tuesday.
What happened?
Rob says, y'all gonna be practicing? I said, yeah, Thursday. He said, cool. I said, Vince, you down to come? And then Vince is like, no, can't go tomorrow. Busy. We're like, bro, that's Wednesday. We said Thursday. So you're obviously free Thursday. He's like, okay. And then he cancels day of on Thursday.
Mind you, this man doesn't have a job. So he's got all the time in the world.
So we're like, why? What's going on? Why can't you just come out? And he said, I planned an evening for myself.
What does that mean?
I said, you've had that all year, except for like the five.
That's your whole life. I plan an evening for myself.
Except for
it's like the last 25 years.
Yeah, it's like I planned out my life.
I planned out my life as an evening to myself.
Yeah, and we're just like
box of Kleenex and lotion.
It's like you can't just come out.
Honestly, probably. Who the fuck knows though?
We're gonna swoop you up. All this and nope, nothing. And it doesn't come. And then we're like, you know what? Let's just leave. Little timeout.
Well, this weekend, the three of us left.
Yeah, no, it's just a dead chat.
They're trying to hurt me.
Yeah, Vince, or what did Rob say? He's like, puts on the diaper.
Oh yeah, what the hell did he say? He's like, no one's home. Vince is gonna put the diaper on because no one's home.
Alrighty then. Alrighty then. This has gone too far.
But a diaper, wearing a diaper when no one's home. It's just definitely gone too far. I started a new group chat. It's called I Heart Rape.
Yeah, Vince said, he's like, oh, now every time I post a video, I gotta look up that name.
Well, that's what you get for being a sucker.
Yeah, because we left the other chat because Vince was admin. So
yeah.
we couldn't kick him out. So
we'll see if he gets timeouts here and there, because the guy spams the chat too much. That's the thing.
With nothing to say.
With stuff that's not funny, and I'm like, you know what? I just start ignoring it. I'm like, all right, guys, I've really had enough of this. I hate that that's in my. I hate that that chat was in my life, and I had to. it was just there.
Dead chat now.
The worst.
Dead chat. Chat's dead.
Yeah, but I played games with him for like an hour. So there's that. I was just playing.
Do you have anything to say?
No, not about that.
Did he have anything to say?
Same old things.
Like what?
Just what he's playing and listening to music, and that's about it.
Boring.
Yeah.
Next.
That's what we're doing right now. Boring.
Yeah.
God, we're so boring.
We're born boring.
Yep. All right. before we get any more boring, do you guys want to go ahead and just fucking take a five and then jump in?
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. Take a five and then we'll jump back on in.
All right. See you guys in five.
Yep. All right, we're back from the break. We got a nice bite-sized bun episode for you guys.
Microwave myself a Arby's sandwich. It's disgusting.
Yeah, it sounds gross.
Yeah. Microwave Arby's?
You're not selling it much.
Well, I'm not trying to sell it. I'm just telling the truth.
Had the Taco Nazo fish burrito. Very good.
I never had the burritos from Taco Nazo. I had the ones from Tacos Baja. Those are good.
I looked for snacks. I didn't find anything good. Wound up having a Rice Krispie Square.
That's good. That's like the best snack there is.
Probably lasted like 2 bites, and now I wish I wanted to add more.
Ran out of popcorn?
No, we had popcorn. It just didn't feel like something salty. Sweet.
I feel like that shit always gets stuck in my teeth, and it makes me paranoid.
I don't know if the paranoia is warranted. Just floss after, man.
Now that I'm thinking, but it like gets up into the like top part of the gum where you can't really floss that out. You kind of have to dig it out with your nail.
Yeah.
But now that I'm thinking about it, I think I actually might have a big bag of popcorn in the cabinet. I'll be right back because I want to eat.
Well, now I kind of want to get another Rice Krispie Square.
All right, we'll be right back.
Yep.
Hey.
All right, we're back. The boys got their snacks.
We got snacks.
I had popcorn.
Got a bag, Rice Krispie Square. Bag of air with some kernels in it.
This bag is just air. I've been reaching all the way to the bottom. I'm just gonna use it in the bag like a funnel that's dump into my gullet.
There's no wrong way to eat that.
So why are we here? Why are we here?
Well, I guess we're gonna be talking about Castle from some part of the Netherlands, I assume.
Yeah, so there was Dan, many band practices, just crying on my shoulder. Haven't picked a Death Doom album. I haven't picked one. I don't know what to pick.
I hadn't picked a Death Doom album. Or not even Death Doom, just Doom. I haven't picked anything Doom since we started the show. I haven't done one.
I was like, bro, just do Castle. Because that's one that you've always talked about.
Yeah, I always talk about Castle. I like Castle. I think my only hesitation was, is Castle that underground?
Kraken.
Is Castle, what's the word? Is Castle lesser known? Do they count?
I think so.
Do people know Castle? I feel like a lot of people already are familiar with this band, aren't they?
Yeah, but doesn't mean we can't talk about them.
I don't think they're too well known. I mean, they were reissued a few years ago from, what was it, Vic or The Crypt. I kind of brought them into the limelight a bit more, so to speak, but before that, it's like, no.
They're like in a weird place between, like, you know, the variations of what Death Doom offers. It's like, you can go gothic, Peacefield 3, you can go very eccentric, like Phlebotomize, and then Castle's like somewhere right in the middle where there's no gothic stuff. It's kind of more streamlined Death Doom, but still has some quirks to it that are
rock and rollish stuff.
Yeah, that make it not so streamlined, and I think it just sits in a odd space. I think an album that we've covered that Joe picked, Enchantment, was one along those lines too.
Yeah, I had Enchantment not jotted down in my notes while I was listening to this one. didn't always give me Peaceville 3 vibes, but every so often I'd think back to Enchantment and Gothic era Paradise Lost.
Yeah, the same thing here. And what I can say about this album, it's like, it seems like the other side of like what Zizma could have done with that Black Sabbath influence, because a lot of these riffs could be like this could be like a fucking stoner doom band, but they're just so atmospheric and brutal, and the way that they have their mid-paced parts still very slow in this album, at least, doesn't necessarily get it up to that type of speed. But I think on their earlier, like their demos, especially, what was it, Purple Visions or something, that one was a bit faster. Like they're doing like straight D beats on there and shit.
I think there's one song on this album that still has a D beat.
Yeah, that's like the second to last song. Castle.
I thought it was Bridge of Snow.
Those ones seem to like drop all their like keys and stuff. Like they'll still have like their kind of like bluesy leads over it, but it was just kind of more mean fucking death doom with those last two tracks. But the rest of them are like, you know, riddled with all the stuff that makes Castle.
That's the thing, right? Like looking at the broader Dutch death doom scene, I can't talk anymore. They were a bit more all over the map and a bit more eccentric than a lot of them. Like when you look at the earlier ones, obviously, like Necroschisma, Sempiternal Death Rain, Delirium, they were, for all intents and purposes, I mean, pioneers obviously, but they were fairly straightforward death doom.
Yeah,
but I mean, even going from there, a lot of the other bands, like I don't know, Mourning, Acrosticon, Gathering, like they were still death doom. They incorporated, like, especially the Gathering, like, on the Moonlight Archer demo, adding in those like weirdo keyboards that kind of give it the personality that it has. It was still fairly straightforward, but Castle feels very abstract. I think it's the best way to look at it.
Well, I mean, look at that album cover.
Well, yeah, and like some of the tracks, it like really comes through. I think that's the one I picked. I don't know when we're gonna listen to that one, first, second, or third, but Alter Reality has some really weird parts in there that kind of feel like they come out in left field. Whereas, as much as I love, again, early Gathering, etc., etc., there aren't a ton of surprises in a lot of those recordings, but that can't be said for Castle. Sometimes you're listening to it, you're like, where the fuck were they thinking when they added this in? It sounds great, but what the fuck were they thinking?
Yeah, and it seems like these guys weren't even in anything before or did anything after. It was just kind of like those two demos and then this album, and then they just kind of dropped off. Didn't do anything else. Yeah,
that was kind of like, I picked up a copy of that Funebrae LP a while ago, and it got me obviously back into that band, and I was like, yeah, what else did these guys ever do? And aside from a couple ex-members who were in some older bands, none of them did anything in metal at all. After recording the album, they just broke up and that was it.
Got nice and proper.
Yeah, but it's weird. And, you know, me being me and weird, I messaged a guy I found on Instagram, asking him, hey, are you the guy in Funebrae? He never answered, so I don't know. It was kind of a tangent, but it's weird that it's funny, right? It's almost like I hate the term outsider metal, death metal, black metal, but it almost feels that way, right? Like these are people who had like for all intents and purposes, from a band involvement perspective anyways, no connections to any other bands. They were just, Castle almost existed in a void in that sense, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then I'm like trying to look up like interviews, anything on this band, and there's nothing. There's, of course,
it was hard too, right? With the band with a name like Castle.
Yeah, I was gonna say like newer bands, like don't like, I don't know if they're just negligent or just didn't give a fuck about you know, using that name, but it's like, damn, this is like such a great album, and there's like no respect. They're just like, all right, we're gonna be Castle, and we're gonna be like heavy metal doom and stoner, and you know, I think there's some like death metal Castles too, but it's like, come on, yeah, man.
But like that was the thing, right? Like I remember first hearing about this album back in the tail end of Napster, early Soulseek days, and I remember chatting about this with a friend of mine, Anu, and we're like, how the hell are we supposed to find and listen to this album? It's just called Castle, and the album's called Castle. Mm-hmm. It doesn't make it easy to find when you're looking for it online.
Yeah, Castle and Castlevania.
Yeah. Like, Castle. If you look up Castle full album on YouTube, it actually does come up, but on like all the other bullshit you pull up at the same time.
Yeah, I had to go like Castle 1994.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think I did the same thing.
Yeah. But,
and I'll just say right now, love, love, love that logo. That's like,
that's a great logo.
Such an amazing logo. It's just a fucking font.
It's but, just like cursive font. It looks terrific, though.
Yeah, the yellow, everything about it, the way it stands against the album art, it's just like perfect. It's
it somehow works, it, right?
It's like so inviting to listen to, or at least like I like when I saw that. Yeah, it makes you want to listen to this. Yeah, I'm like, what does this and sound
you hear
like?
You hear it's death doom, and you see this, you're like, oh man, this is. I'm hoping this is really good, and it is really good.
Yeah. Ugh.
Like, yeah, and it was,
one at a time?
Go for it. Yeah, we all went at the same time.
Calm down, guys. Calm down.
All right, Fred's the leader. Go ahead.
I'm the leader?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The hell? This is your pick. You go ahead.
Oldest first. I think it would still be Fred if we went by height.
Probably.
Really? I'm not that tall.
Yeah, but we're really short.
Really? How tall are you guys?
5'5".
Yeah, I'm like 5'6".
Really?
Little Mexican.
Gravity's hard on us.
You know, band photos always make people look taller than they actually are, I guess.
Yeah, you gotta get that bottom-up logo angle.
I never would have thought I'm at least like 3 inches higher than you guys.
There you go.
We're just little Mexicans.
No, I was just saying.
That was, I was gonna say you laughed at that.
I mean, you said it, so I'm allowed.
Yeah, I can. Yeah, but I can say it.
Since
you, I'm just kidding.
Since you said it, I'm allowed to laugh at it.
You are. All jokes. I'm not here to tell who can't say what about what not and whatever.
No, I was just going to say the label that released this, Malodorous Mangled Innards, was a fairly interesting label that had a really like broad depth of bands in there. It had like Finnish black metal, it had Castle, it had Dead, it had
Clotted Symmetric Sexual Organ,
had Castle, yeah,
Evolved,
had Ethereal Winds, had Gut, Gore Beyond Necropsy, Naked Whipper, Phlebotomized, mm-hmm. Soul Grind. Mm. I'm just naming
that
every
naked, the Naked Whipper album is so good, but
yeah, the guitar tone sounds fucking painful. Ouch.
Yeah, no, it's nasty.
Pain streaks.
But yeah, like a cool label that was on too, and it kind of fits with kind of eccentric variety that the label offers. There's that EP they have from Winter Semester is really cool, if you guys have ever seen that or heard that. Worth checking out.
Winter Semester?
Yeah.
I just saw that. Where am I looking here?
It's like a blue and red album cover.
It's on the Maladoris releases. I'm looking here. I don't see it.
It's all the way at the bottom.
Oh, mm-hmm. This. Okay, let's see. What's good? The album here?
The EP.
The album's good. I have the EP, so I spent more time with that. And it's...
I don't know what to expect looking at this album cover here.
It's fairly, like, straightforward black metal. I mean, there's nothing super original, I guess, about it. Just well executed black metal. The first comparison point I want to go to is Cetherial off the top of my head.
Okay.
So, yeah, that sort of thing.
Alright.
Anyways, tangent again, sorry.
Anyways, yeah. I think before we all spoke at once, I was going to bring up, where did they get this album cover from? The thing that stands out most to me is the guy with the pointy hood and the glasses,
yeah,
and the fucking nose. He always stood out to me. The other stuff never really stood out to me. Just that face, that guy.
Yeah. No, that's what I've always remembered about this cover, too. It looks medieval.
Yeah.
Like, I could not tell you where it's from, but it looks... Well, what weirds me out more isn't the artwork. It's the red arrows and lines and squares.
What does that mean? Is that like circuitry? What the fuck does that even mean?
Yeah, I have no idea. There? All I can tell is that it intentionally forms a square in the middle, but I don't know what any of that is supposed to represent.
That's the castle we met along the way.
You know something? I didn't even read these lyrics.
I wonder if that is the, like, the layout of some sort of castle.
Might be.
Oh, it's like schematics?
I mean...
The floor plans?
It'd be a weird-looking castle, but I can't think of a better explanation.
Okay, so there's songs here about traveling to the fourth dimension.
As one does.
Songs about big walls of ice protect me from the outside. What's the song Castle about? Billions of years ago, I was there, placed on a rock in a lake that borders far in the middle of the waste. Mustard seeds growing on the walls, impale them with your lust. The Archmage scorched the earth with his magic breath. Man was scattered all over the earth, lost in too many different languages.
Yeah, okay. Like, impale them with your lust, stun them with your greed.
Yeah. And then you got the first one, Chasing Unicorns, the first demo. Mm-hmm. Always thought that was kind of interesting, too.
Yeah, they got some good demo titles. In Purple Visions, too. Purple Visions, too.
Chasing Unicorns?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And it seems like on the second album, like, on these guys' like demos, they're kind of like streamlined of like nothing like came out of the blue. Like it seemed like they always had those keyboards in there, like that whole Death Doom atmosphere. It seems like they just kind of refined it and like, I guess, trimmed the fat of like the faster stuff, and I think expanded more of their atmosphere and what they could do with the keyboards, like especially on Exposed. Like that one just feels like you're like walking into Elysium or something in the middle of that track. It's like I don't know, I don't want to say otherworldly, but it's like spiritual.
Yeah, the intro works. The intro melody for that is really weird, where it's like, kind of have it like just kind of build around that little melody.
And then when you turn on this album, it's like it sounds like it could start off like a fucking Carbonized song.
Oh on yeah, the yeah. I forgot it starts off like that. It starts off kind of like God, there was something in particular that I thought. This is what I get for not writing notes. Oh, you know what it kind of sounds like? It kind of sounds like dystopia at the beginning.
Oh yeah, with like the bass and the.
Yeah, doom 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 doom. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. The Emperor. That's not the Emperor's Children, is it? What song?
The
is
Seventh
that?
Empire.
Seventh Empire. Yeah.
Emperor's Children was a really cool track. That was almost my pick.
I almost picked the first one, but Exposed got me.
I realized when I was picking my song for this one, I really often go for the very first track. Because I'm such a simp, I'm just like, hey, this sounds cool. And then I just go with it.
Such a simp.
Well, it's usually like a definitive statement how albums start off, and usually the ones we pick are they at least grab me in that way too, so it's like if someone else doesn't pick it, I would, but in this case I think there's more diamonds than there is rough.
Yeah, if there's a song that's not like the strongest, it's probably the final one to me.
Yeah, yeah, I'd agree with that.
Over traveling.
I don't think it was bad, but it was.
What's that, Paul?
I said over traveling.
What do you mean? No, I said if there's one that doesn't stick out to me, it's track 7.
Oh, I thought you said that one does. I was like, no. Oh, I thought you were going with traveling.
No, which is too bad, because I think Bridge of Snow is like the most evocative title of all of them.
it's cool. It's cool. It's still good. I just feel like that's like the weakest track.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think there's any weak tracks on the album, but that was overall the worst.
Well, out of like their short songs, the first two are like definitely outshine that last one. They could have definitely maybe cut it or put it up in between the very long songs, but you know, who are we?
Well, I mean, I guess they. I kind of see what their approach was, putting the shorter songs in the on the outside and the longer ones in the middle, kind of ramping up and down. But
yeah, it's like kind of
the opposite approach of Blood, Fire, Death.
Excuse me, I had popcorn kernel in my throat.
Better than in your teeth.
This is my nightmare.
It's happening.
Those things just get stuck everywhere.
Just everywhere. They're in my windpipe. They're in my lungs. They're in my heart. Popcorn kernels in my heart.
It's happening.
No, but yeah, like how'd you find this album? I know. I think you've talked about it as long as I've known you too.
Yeah. I don't exactly remember when. That's a good question, man. It had to have been like around the time I met you or just before I met you. I think 2011 in particular, because I remember first hearing this album when I was smoking a lot of weed with Big Chris and this dude named Alan. And I was huge into like stoner doom stuff at the time. So I think I was listening to Bong Ripper a lot and like Stone Jesus and stuff. And Castle just kind of came on the radar as like, I don't know, doom band. Check it out.
Yeah, it seems like much more, you know, like those bands are more like surface level of weed bands. But this one's like not necessarily like a bad trip or anything, but it's like you'll probably get a lot more out of listening to this.
I do remember, because it was me and Chris. His parents were gone, like, to work or something. I think it might have been during the summer. And we, like, smoked in the backyard, and I put this on, and I just remember, I think it was the song Exposed that I put on with that weird melody. And I was like, man, I was just thinking, God, this is really fucking good. And I remember Chris was, like, digging it, too. He was like, oh, pretty sick, boo.
Yeah, where I feel like if this would, like I said, be a little bit more like up to pace with like Sonar Doom and like more like immediate, it would really show with those Black Sabbath influences that this has. But I think the way that they interpret it and the way that they utilize that influence is like way more satisfying, because you can get, I think I made the comparison of like Death and Roll, like just being, it could be like an offshoot of stoner metal and shit too. It's just the way that these are used, instead of like being the main hook riff, it's like they'll just use them as like melodies to get to the doom sections rather than dooming out on a Black Sabbath riff.
Yeah, I mean, in that sense, I feel like this is kind of the perfect album for me to pick, like as a doom metal pick, just because I don't really feel like it has much to do with death metal at all. You know what I mean? If that makes sense. I don't think there are any really death metal-y parts on this.
Yeah, I think the closest it gets is probably just like the chords that they play during the slower parts.
Those are just like vocals, slow melodies.
Yeah, vocals.
Yeah, besides the vocals, like the music itself doesn't really do anything that would be constituted as a death metal band. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like if you put kind of like Cathedral vocals over this, you got a doom metal band.
Yeah. I think I always paired those bands together, I guess just after the Architecture.
Who, Cathedral?
Yeah.
Cathedral and this band?
Yeah.
The one band I was thinking, because it's honestly, it's hard to pinpoint like an immediate influence for these guys. Were you thinking the same thing? Like, it doesn't exactly sound like anybody in particular.
Yeah, I think the main one that I had was like Zizma, but I mean, that's like, doesn't sound anything like this. It just seems like it's cut from the same cloth, like being influenced by Black Sabbath and doing it in a, you know, unique way.
Well, there's another band from the Netherlands, Death Doom band. They were called Mystic Charm.
Yes.
You guys are familiar. Fred's familiar with that one. There you go.
Yeah,
they had a chick vocalist. I feel like musically and like tonally, the Mystic Charm album is probably the most similar to Castle. And which is interesting because they both come out in the same year, in 94.
Yeah.
That's the thing, right? A lot of the Dutch bands seemed fairly straightforward. They didn't go too... I mean, I guess Creepmime was a bit more experimental in their approach.
Creepmime just felt like a melodic death metal band, a little like slightly more brutal. Kind of like Creepmime reminded me of Ill Disposed, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
I thought Ill Disposed was a bit more brutal, I guess.
Ill Disposed is in a like surface level, if you're just looking at them on the surface, it kind of like pretty straightforward, but the inner workings of what they do is slightly brutal. I can see where people would be like, oh, this sounds brutal for its time, or the guitar tone is brutal or something.
But yeah, it's just something to do with that Danish sound. Like, for whatever reason,
yeah,
like, them...
Yeah, it has a very specific sound. Not really, like...
Yeah, them, Dominus, like, Infernal Torment, they were straight-up death metal, but it just sounded a bit more brutal. I don't know what it is about those Danish bands.
The production and the fucking...
could be.
The tones. And probably the way that they play it. But if you look at it, like... a little more closely, it's pretty straightforward. It's not as techy as you would imagine.
Yeah, I can see that.
Here, I'm chewing on this popcorn. I'm still going for it.
Well, while Dan's trying to get that piece of kernel out of his teeth, shall we listen to a track?
Yeah, which one did you end up going with?
Me? I went with track 3, Ultra Reality.
Alright, I think that's the first up to bat, so we'll be right back. Alright, we're back from our altered reality.
Ah. I feel altered after that.
It's such a weird kind of stream of consciousness sort of track, almost. It almost feels like an ambient interlude.
Yeah. I think the way the drums carry not only the song, but the whole album is like, it seems like it's doing a lot of the heavy lifting from, you know, getting from part to part, because there's leads throughout the songs that not only like accelerate with the beats, but it also descends with them as well. And with those with the drumming bringing it up to tempo and back down, is just like such a, like, I don't know, it's like such a intentful way to use that instrument. And like, not only is he just doing a hi-hat sort of beat, he's like doing tom fills throughout the whole way. It seems more of like a percussionist behind it, rather than just like a, you know, like a metronome, which I always bring up with like Death Doom. There's bands that could just like keep the tempo, and then, or drummers that just keep the tempo, and then there's guys that are able to use the drums more of like a, like a instrument, playing like, I wouldn't say like melodies, but lines with the fills to bring it into different sections. And those toms just sound like so massive in there too. It's, you could feel like the impact every fill that he hits those with, even the kick drum.
Yeah, this is it's so hard to like pinpoint this, because it doesn't really sound gothic at all.
No.
Which I feel like most death doom that's not totally death metaled out is that's what people would go to, is the kind of peace fill sounds. Like, oh, it sounds gothic. I don't think it sounds gothic really at all.
No.
And it also it doesn't really have the crushing death doom thing going. It doesn't sound like Rippikulu or Disembowelment. It sort of has this kind of, not occult rock, but like surrealistic rock and roll approach.
Yeah, it's like a life death or life doom album or something.
Yeah, it's like it almost wants to paint a story for you. If you look at some of the lyrics, they're very strange. It wants to take you into like surrealism, real, you know, pretty much, I would say. And Fred mentioned at the beginning that intro is pretty funeral doom. In 1994, I think the only funeral doom stuff was probably just coming out of Finland.
And Norway to a degree. Funeral.
Yeah. Okay, I guess you're
right. I mean, literally funeral, that's about it.
Yeah, well, I like that these guys sort of can utilize that and just have a really cool intro and outro. And then the middle, it's not exactly stoner doom.
No.
Like Witchfinder General or Cathedral or something, but it does have a really epic mood to it. Like
I think it's that that drum beat, man. It's so
the
great.
Drum beat is, yeah, it's driving. It's driving, but it stays in the same place. But it also moves you forward. It's kind of interesting.
It's cruising.
And so the guitars are kind of allowed to chug along. And sort of on the second guitar, you may miss it if you're not paying too much attention, but there's a lot of strange tail-end melodies that I've never heard from any other band. They do these weird little, like, arpeggiated chromatic things, but they seem to move like in a, like, fucking, what's the word? Not a circle, the other thing. What's an egg shaped like? I can't think of the word. I can't think of the word. No. What's that shape?
An elliptical.
No, not an elliptical. Like a octa something? Why can't I think of the word? Not a circle. But see, this is what we do on the show. We learn our shapes, folks.
Here we go. What is the shape of an egg? Oval.
Yeah. Oval.
Really?
Yeah, really. Well, I said egg. I couldn't think of the word oval.
I didn't think an oval would be, like, not...
You can make oval. You can make oval shapes on the guitar when you're doing chromatic, little, like, melodies like that.
I mean, sure, but I just didn't think an oval could be pinched on one side like an egg. I thought it was just. I learned something today. This is why we do this.
Yeah, this is why we talk about oval shapes and eggs and eat your hard-boiled eggs.
I think in retrospect, picking Alter Reality as my track and making it the first we play from this album is almost misrepresentation. It's kind of it almost feels like a instrumental interlude, even though it's not instrumental. It just has that vibe to it where it's just like a bridge from one to the other, like bridging from the shorter tracks at the beginning to the longer tracks that come after.
Yeah.
It's a great track, and that's why I picked it, but it's not very representative of the rest of the album, I think.
You don't think so, huh? Well, I guess we'll find out.
Guess we're gonna.
Yeah, and I think the keys here are very subtle.
Yeah.
They seem to be, like, having, like, some Pink Floyd sort of influence there, because they're doing, like, arpeggios and shit like that, going into different voicings rather than what you hear later on, which are just, I think early on, it's, like, just actual, like, piano keys being played.
Yeah, they keep changing it up with the different types of keyboards, I think.
Yeah.
Change it up.
I just wanted to mention, too, those, like, guitar scratching noises that come in between the riffs, and then, like, the volume, when you play with the volume knob, it goes...
Yeah, the At the Gates.
I think Paul said
violin.
That was, like, At the Gates. Yeah, what's it called? Time Ghoul straight up does that trick with the volume knob.
Yeah, and
yeah.
I think that was during the section where it was just drums and bass, and I think the bass really fills it out with just how atmospheric it is. It's not really doing any sort of, at least from what I hear, any like leads or anything.
There's a lot of subtleties here, man.
That
are really good.
And, like, the vocals, with the clean vocals just, like, coming, panning left to right.
Yeah, it's like, it's not so clear what they're doing, and I think that's cool that it's not super clear why they did that.
Yeah.
Some of these ideas are questionable, but I think they work really, really well.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. They're not so, like, far gone and, like, unhinged in a, like, progressive way that like phlebotomizes, but they still are like, they're probably just listening to the same thing, but you know, keeping it more atmospheric death doom than
So far they did like two different death doom tricks, not tricks, but two different things that like most death doom bands would do only one of, and I think that's moving forward, we'll see that these guys basically can pull off every style of death doom in this album and make it their own.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And they're like so masterful at,
or just every style of doom, really.
Switching into different tempos and parts, like damn, this is happening now.
Yeah, it's you just don't like, even notice that the riff change, and you're like,
just
building. That's cool.
Yeah, it just keeps going, like Fred says, like kind of like a stream of consciousness.
Hmm.
Stream of piss.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Well, should we expose the stream of piss with the next song?
Yeah, let's expose ourselves. That's fine.
Yes.
All right. it's going to be the one right after it. 10 minutes long. I think it's the longest track.
Longest track. Get ready for the longest track, everybody.
Exposed.
Yeah,
10 minutes. And those who skip will be exposed in our data.
Yeah, they will.
Yeah, the database can show us that.
All right, we'll be right back. we're back from the second track.
That sucked. I'm sorry I missed it the first time.
I know, I was going to mention it right now. Again, this does not suck. Fred forgot.
You can't say it when it's your pick.
No, it's the best time. It's the best time to say it.
It's like, sorry guys, this one sucked, huh?
It sucked, didn't it, asshole?
No, but like, here they just like open up the pearly gates for you and did this whole
sound like Asia
prog rock section that was totally, I wouldn't say expected, but this band was capable of doing, and they did it like perfectly.
That middle part sounds like I'm floating off into the water.
Yeah, it's like
in the sunrise.
Some out of body experience, and then it just brings you back. And just the way that it opens up with that that first note on the keyboard. And then they just keep progressing instead of like trying to hold on to that and build atmosphere that way. They're just going with the rest of the track, you know.
We're able to build atmosphere by playing music.
Yeah, I don't think anything really is supposed to be holding, you know, the torch here with like being like, oh, this is a band with the keyboards, this is a band with the solos. It's like this is the band with the songs. You know, like I think everything is like played for the songs. Like even when the guitars, the keyboards, the drums all stand out, it's all intentful and not like it's not like a rock star vibe at all. Like, oh, here I can play the guitar, like hear me shred. It's
you
like
can't shred though.
Yeah, and it's all done, I think, purposefully, to just keep building and building the track. And I think the way that they took the prog rock route without, like, so much putting... There wasn't really any, like, metal during that section. It was all, like, a complete, kind of love note to that music.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it was like an ethereal moment.
Yeah, and I think the way most bands would go about having a section like that in their song would be to drop out the drums, make it its whole own interlude to make the song like fucking 4 minutes longer than it should be.
It would feel like a cut and paste thing.
Yeah, where these guys do it so seamlessly, and from the beginning, they're playing with this like very haunting melody, and they just keep building and building on that, and it keeps returning back. And I think it's just one of the like best motifs and best Death Doom songs, honestly. Like, this is such a standout for me. Not only in the album, but in the genre.
I think this one really highlights just how good the drumming is, and
yeah,
I everything about this album is great, but the drumming is hands down my favorite part of it. It's just so on point and original for what it is. Like, he shifts into whatever he needs to make that part just sound perfect, and the drumming just nails it every single time.
Yeah, and when they go to this amazing, like, faster bit outside or on the other side of that that prog rock section, it isn't like doing so much like fills or anything to connect those parts. It's doing measures, like just one measure of like a certain beat, like that you wouldn't hear. And I think in Traveling it does the same thing, and it sounds disjointed, but I think it, you know, just builds that, like, it shows the character that this drummer has, where it's like, I'm gonna be very strong arm and have this beat in here no matter what you guys say.
Are you talking about the, like, Divine Eve D beat?
No, it's like the pagan beat for like 1 second. It's like a Isengard beat in Traveling. Okay.
Yeah.
But in here, it's just like Fred said. It really is a like a focal point here. But it's not flashy in any sort of way. It's like just serving its purpose in an innovative way.
I like how I think Fred was getting popcorn at this point where I mentioned this to Paul, but that original like spooky kind of arpeggiated intro thing, they bring that back maybe a few minutes later, and the second time that they do it, they have like a split millisecond where one of the notes changes and it sounds beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds like pretty instead of creepy, but only for like 2 milliseconds.
Yeah.
Isn't that weird?
And it does that for only like that, like within like that sort of, I guess, repetition of that melody. It does that only there. And it kind of, I wouldn't say the melody itself is like dissonant, but there's like that sort of like, I wouldn't even say like the other notes sound sour, but that one just sounds like so sweet. In comparison.
Yeah, it's a weird contrast.
Interesting way of putting it, but it works.
Yeah. And the vocals just carry it on, like, so perfectly. Like, the intro itself, like, where they're just building, like, with the, like Fred said, like, avalanche drums at the beginning, and then you get in, like, the quarter note, you know, toms just going into, you know, the rest of the track. It, having the vocals over that is like, I don't know, it's just such a nice touch. Like, I don't think many bands would be like, oh yeah, I have vocals here. Like, they're like, no, we need to have, you know, everyone participating, you know, not as much as they can, but where it's like needed. And I feel like other bands would take moments like that and like the interlude without like having the drums in there as like just such minute decisions, but they pay off so much in the long run. At least for me, when I hear stuff like that, it's like actually surprising, because a lot of bands would not have vocals during that intro. They wouldn't have drums over that interlude part, especially the way that they're both doing that, like the death growls. Feel like that could have been like a spoken word part at the beginning, but you know, they didn't choose to do that. And the drums, feel like he could have done like some cymbal work there, but he was just keeping the death doom beat there. And it's just refreshing to hear, especially 30 years later.
It just feels like every decision they made on this album was the right decision.
Yeah,
like there's Like Paul was saying, like there's a part where they could have just dropped everything out, or just had an ambient section, and they chose not to do that, and that was a great decision. It just, and that sort of thing they just consistently do through the whole album, where you think they're going to do the predictable, the easy, and they don't, and it comes out even better than what you expected it would sound like.
Yeah. It's like not so streamlined, but having those parts in like just, I guess, quirks that it has within this album, it all is within their grasp, and they, you know, have a death grip on it, because they're able to perform it so well.
Shit, yeah, they are.
Yeah, I think everything from the band photo to the name to, it's hard to tell if these guys really have a concept, like if their concept is surrealist, like alternate universe medieval times or something, but whatever it is, god, it works so good.
Yeah, because I think in the intro it does sound very it was like giving me a sort of Renaissance vibe with the keyboards, and it really ascends with the drums and kind of feels like you're getting cornered into a section, and then it just releases into the doom sections, and the way that it sort of you know, trudges up and down these hills and dynamics is so good.
God, the more we're listening to this right now and talking about it, I feel like the Grinch. My heart is growing a few sizes more for Castle. I'm like, God, these guys are geniuses.
I think that's
very serious medical condition.
I was gonna say, I think that's
the gorged heart. That's the kernels.
Yeah, I was gonna say it's the kernels adding up.
It's the kernels.
But yeah,
chuckled like that. I never heard that laugh before.
Yeah, it feels like they could have honestly ended the album there and would have been such a high note, but they keep going, and there's even more for them to expose. So should we get into Traveling, unless you guys got anything else more to say about this track? It seems to have left me a bit speechless after all that I said about it.
One more thing that you mentioned, Paul. You said that the second riff that comes in, you're like, oh, that's probably the most Black Sabbath type riff. To me, that doesn't sound quite. I get that it like has the same tempo, but the atmosphere that it exudes is a little bit more just weird.
Yeah, and I was gonna say, I think the way that Black Sabbath would go about it would just hang on those sort of like, I guess, what do you call it, like bending notes, they would just go back and you know, pluck those bending notes again. But these riffs, that riff in particular goes on so long, like there's so many you know, turns that it takes, and then it comes back to it's like catchy for a moment, but I don't know if that's necessarily what it's like going for. You know, it's like just having those bends in there, that's like kind of just like ear candy for like anyone that likes fucking electric guitar. Yeah. And then they go into, you know, their more death doom notes afterward, and then repeat back to you know, the top of the riff, and you kind of forget that it was like a Black Sabbath kind of like ode.
Yeah, I mean, that riff, listening to it now, it kind of makes sense what you were saying at the beginning. You were sort of comparing this to like Death and Roll a little bit. I think that if that riff was played faster, it could basically just be a lubricant riff. Like, it would make sense.
And that, like, that's kind of what I was getting to. Like, if they were able to play these riffs really high pace, it would be Death and Roll. But if they were to crank it up to like a mid pace, sort of in between this and Death and Roll, it would be like a stoner riff.
So they pick the perfect tempo with everything, kind of.
Yeah.
Yeah, they really do.
All right, should we pack our bags, travel?
Yeah. Shall we travel on? As the weird travel on?
Yeah, as the weird travel on. There you go.
Ah, shit, I just closed my window. Alright.
Alright, we'll be right back.
Pull it up again. We'll be right back.
we're back. Man, what fucking song. And all these long songs don't even feel as long as they are because it's so encapsulating the whole way through.
Yeah. It's crazy. Like,
changes here.
I'm literally staring at the video, looking at the timer going, and I know it's been 10 minutes, but at the same time, I'm like, that wasn't 10 minutes.
Yeah.
How is this happening?
Yeah, it takes you out of time or surrealistic time or something.
Yeah.
It's almost like the clocks are melting or something.
Always humming that wee noo nee noo, and then there was that other part in the beginning that's like, how the fuck did it go? It sounds like it's crying. It sounded like the guitar's going boo hoo. It sounded like 3D Squeldon. it's like boo doo nee doo 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 doo. God, there's so many winter riffs in here.
Yeah.
Incredible.
To me, the drumming is just the absolute highlight on this. Like, it's so good.
Yeah.
It's unique for this album, and it's perfect for it.
Yeah, like, the first half is just, like, DB, and it's, like, perfect mid-pace, you know, death metal beat to do.
Mm-hmm. I really am curious what their influences on this are, and I know it's not anything to jump to conclusions to, but the fact that none of the members were in any other metal bands, that on the band photo no one's wearing a band shirt, it's like, how involved were they in the scene? Because it's almost like not being involved and not hearing what bands like Spina Bifida or whatever in the scene, even Asphyx, were doing and just choosing their own way. I don't know.
Yeah, it's like stand-up comedy. Like, a lot of people, while they're like writing their shit, they won't listen to anyone else's, so they won't like subconsciously steal a premise or a joke entirely. It's like these guys are just you know, this is just laying their soul on the line.
Mm-hmm.
Red mentioned Spina Bifida. They're on the thank you list for the second demo.
And he said, yeah,
Purple Visions.
Gothicles, too.
It says, thanks and greetings. Gothicles, a band called Delirious, who I don't know. A band called Beyond Belief, I don't think I know that. Acrostichon. Acrostichon? I don't know how to pronounce their name.
I've always called them Acrosticon, but I don't. I've never heard anyone else say it, so.
Band called Thy Grief Eternal, Rising mm-hmm. Nation. And it says, for in the thank you list, it says, our parents, in parentheses, we know what you did, we won't forget.
Book the studio time, pay for it.
And then there's a band called The Awakening, and in parentheses it says, sorry.
And you know, not too far from Fred bringing up the band photo, but I was saying, like, during all these, like, drumming sections where it like literally speeds up after every repetition and then slows right back down, it's like kind of telling where the bass player is like looking at the drummer in the photo like, damn, like I just got to follow this guy wherever he takes me, because they're just holding down that rhythm section so well for you know, the guitars and keys to kind of you know, fuck around with the landscape and go over with all these awesome melodies and solos throughout the whole album. And I think especially in this song where it's all like just so like speeding up and then just kind of like floating down like a feather back down to you know, these doom sections. And again, it's just like so seamless. It doesn't seem like anything is like cut and paste here. It all seems like organic songwriting, like these guys are just jamming and coming up with these awesome parts. And honestly, I don't think I would want another, I would want to hear what these guys did after. Maybe they would do like a Dominus to Volbeat sort of thing with the way that these leads are going.
Yeah, it might turn out like Subject, the Wild Horses from the Clouds.
I so wanted that to be a Death Grind release, and I listened to it. I'm like, oh, it's not.
Well, somebody leaves a comment on the Castle YouTube. It says, here perhaps lays the roots of Sky Contact, which is, I believe, the second...
Phlebotomized, right?
Yes, the second Phlebotomized one with a stupid fucking baby on it.
Yeah.
There's like a fish with a guitar tail. It looks stupid. From what I remember, Phlebotomized second album sounds more like atmospheric Greek death metal, like Septic Flesh or something. Or like Garden of Gods, or, you know, something like that. Less cool than Garden of Gods and Septic Flesh. For sure. But yeah, you heard in that, there were like two parts in this song that Paul brought up earlier, or one that I wanted to bring up too. That like little chugging death metal part, that was probably like the only death metal instrumentation where it's like chugga 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 chugga, quickly broken up by that, like a jangly D beat thing.
Yeah, it was so fast.
Yeah, it happened so quickly.
Yeah, it's just like, hey,
don't forget, we're a death metal band.
Chugga 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 chugga. They go right.
Yeah. We go chugga 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 chugga.
And I think you were
talking about that disjointed part that happened like super quick.
It was, yeah, like one, it's like count. Towards the end, like within the last minute, it goes into this like 3/4 sort of like pagan beat, like do da gada do da gada, and then at first listen, it sounded so like just out of nowhere, like, oh damn, this guy just pulled that beat out of out of his ass, but like listening here, it was like perfect within the context. I guess it is a headphone thing, but I was gonna say, what was the riff that sounded like just a really slowed down thrash riff? Like that shit was fucking awesome.
It's the one that goes dun 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 dun, I think. Maybe not, but yeah, there was.
No, that's the one.
I mean, it sounded right.
Yeah.
Is that the one? Okay.
Yeah, and yeah, just the way you pointed that out, it's just like these guys were they have like such a unique riffing style to them, and again, like that riff could have been like a traditional sort of like just regular doom sort of riff. Dun, 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 dun. But they'll just like go right back to it, and it's like all these parts in themselves are like so catchy, but they're not like keeping them away from you. Like throughout the song, they'll go back to it, and in that album, like all those awesome parts that you hear, the melodies, they always go back to them later on, just in a way you wouldn't expect them to. It's not like in a verse chorus sort of way. It's more in I don't know, just like, oh yeah, we should bring that sick ass part back again. But again, it might just be me not knowing too much about composition, where all these riffs might as well be entwined and connected in certain ways that is beyond me.
Just kind of the art of
in like a music
a song together.
Yeah, like in a music theory way, I guess. But yeah,
these guys
just
don't know nothing about music theory. I'm assuming.
I mean, they look like professors. the way they're dressed.
I just never heard anything like this.
Yeah, Richard
there's
almost
no
looks
other, there's
like
no, there's no other death doom albums that sound anything near like this besides Mystic Charm, but this is a million times better than that.
Yeah.
Oh, crack my spine. Ooh, crack my neck.
Yeah, I was going to say the bass, the rhythm guitarist almost looks like Bradley Cooper right there.
Does he?
Oh, yeah. I can see that.
Let me see. The rhythm guitarist. Where's he? Oh, Richard?
Yeah. Then
Richard
Eric
looks like, I don't know who he looks like.
Eric almost
yeah, Eric looks,
looks
like
a
teacher.
I was going to say, he looks like a really young version of that guy that's like yelling at the trumpet guy.
Yeah, he goes, "Who are you? I walked Bob Dylan up on stage. Who the fuck are you? You know talent."
Yeah,
like, that guy.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, you like, and I could say that. But
you're a hack.
But Castaway and a hack. These guys are, I don't know, they produce one of the best, most interesting death doom albums without having to be like phlebotomized. Or you know,
phlebotomized have always kind of turned me off. Never really cared about them.
They lean way too much into you know, the other shit where these guys,
instruments, I'm afraid I don't care. I'm afraid I don't give a shit.
Where these guys are more, I don't know. It seems like they're down to earth, but they're sort
more,
of like
more based, more based and red pilled.
Yeah, more down to earth, but they're hovering a bit. They're a bit above everyone else, I think.
Everyone else, definitely. They're confusing. Their band name is confusing. Their album art is confusing. Their music is confusing. But
yeah,
I think
I don't mind being confused.
yeah, like I said, even Chris, when I showed my friend who's just into hip hop stuff, you know, sometimes these Mexican guys, like, they'll hear metal stuff, they'll be like, yeah, hey, this is kind of cool, like, you know, they kind of like it. Castle, it's easy to get into Castle, it's easy to like.
Would you say that, and this is accessible?
Yeah, definitely. It's really not. I don't think it would, like, push anybody away. I think it's pretty accessible.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of, like, almost open-ended parts that people can kind of sink into without the threat of what death metal is looming over it too much.
Yeah, I don't think it's, like, so, like, extreme in the death metal sense. It's more,
it's
like,
not even really extreme. It's basically, like, a heavy rock album. A heavy doom rock album. But with death metal vocals and, like, a few weird kind of shifts in like tempo and basically that's it, you know. It's pretty accessible, I'd say.
And you're saying, like, this song seems to condense the, like, dynamics of, like, the mood shifts in it. They do it so
all the songs have, like, mood shifts and they change constantly. But that last one, Traveling, that's probably the most extreme version of the way they do it. But not to say that the rest of the songs don't have, like, nice surprises on them. All of them do. But Traveling might be the ones, I think all the three that we picked are pretty much the ultimate winners here. Not to say any of them are bad, but those are the best ones.
Yeah, like the first two songs, I think they serve a different purpose than those. I feel like those were kind of like the like, all right, we reeled you in, now here's you know,
here's the real shit.
Yeah and then at the end it kind of just, like, drops all that sort of I don't want to say, like, flowery stuff, but it kind of just goes more streamlined death doom, you know, kind of sandwiching these you know, this like hidden gem in the middle of the album, which are the three tracks that we've played.
I don't think that it's probably obvious that these guys are into prog rock, but they've done everything that they, all their influences that they've taken and, like, put into their stuff, it's so deeply, like, hidden by the fact that their Castle, there's, like, not really any room for dissection. Almost, it's super hard to pick apart, or at least they've done it so well that there's nothing obvious here. It's just God, he's fucking genius.
Well, again, I think, like, the 70s. More proggy or rocky stuff is a big influence, and you can hear it in here. Then they metalize it well, so much that it's not immediately obvious that's what they're trying to do, just because the atmosphere is so dense in what they create, they don't really think about where individual influences may come from. You kind of just go with it and just float away with it.
Yeah. And I think what you were saying when you you know, were coming up with an album and you listened to it within the last week, you said like, oh yeah, I have like no complaints about it, and yeah, like this is a perfect album, I think.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
Yeah.
Should we get into
it's pretty problems spotless.
With Death Doom in general, just because there's
Just a lot of
well, it's hard to pull off, right?
I guess
it's hard to pull off and not let it veer into boredom.
Yeah, I was gonna say it takes a lot of
seriously.
It takes a lot of like endurance to get through a lot of tracks, but like here it seems like time isn't even a matter here. It's just like you're just going through the songs and feeling every moment, and without having to repeat sections 16 times to you know, exude the point an across. Atmosphere. Yeah,
yeah, in about 5 seconds there's not even gonna be matter.
No.
Yeah, it seems like to go. It seems like this might be a bizarre sort of you know, line of thought, but it seems like it's like the counterpart to Dark Tranquility's like method of going from melodic riff to melodic riff. They're sort of doing that within this Death Doom context, where they're having a lot of these you know, different riffs in these Doom sections and songs in general, where it's all coming at you new and progressing on what they just built. Like they're the way that the lead goes in exposed, and they use that tail end of a riff to go right into the next one. It seems to all just be like, again, stream of consciousness, and it's just like I'll follow wherever the castle leads.
Yeah. But is that Paul's final thought?
Yeah, that was mine. So your guys.
Beautiful.
Fred, go.
Yeah, I was waiting for that. Yeah, really an album that stands out in that scene and in Death Doom as a whole. I mean, I don't know if I can call it my favorite, just because Necroschisma exists. But
Necroschisma is so different than this, though.
Oh, yeah, no, it's totally different. I mean, it still falls in the realm of Death Doom, but this is so much more. Like, Necroschisma is just so, well, necro. And this is much.
Hey, all I know is we got a castle episode, not a Necroschisma one.
Hey, Paul, this is my final thoughts, not yours. This is like such a. I hate using this because it sounds flowery, but it's such a pretty album. Like it,
also they like pull.
Doom. Yep.
Yeah. Like they pull it off so well, and like the I think what speaks to what they were able to pull off here is just how natural everything sounds and flows together, and B, just how these songs that are nearing like what 10 minutes long at their longest don't feel anywhere near that long. Like it's incredible. Like these tracks feel like they blow by in like 4 or 5 minutes, and next thing you know, we've heard the entire 48 minute album. Yeah, just an impressive recording altogether. Like they pulled off something remarkably unique here. Like Dan was saying, like it's hard to pull off Death Doom. Like it's so easy for this to veer into a direction that's just repetitive and boring, and they avoid that at every step of the way. But I just want to know what that album cover is, man. Like, I need to know what these lines are. That's where my mind goes.
Circuitry, maybe.
It looks like circuitry, but like...
It's the floor plans for the castle.
What would you have circuitry over...
Somebody stole the fridge.
Like, free. Superimposed over a medieval drawing like that for? Like, I don't get it. What the hell's going on?
I don't know. It looks cool, though.
It works.
I like it better that it's there than if it wasn't.
It almost looks, like, alchemical. But yeah, I agree. Like, if it... That... Those red lines being there make it stand out and weird. Otherwise, it'd just be another album with black and white artwork and...
Yeah, medieval art.
Yellow scripted logo.
Yellow scripted logo looks terrific.
It does. It looks remarkably good. And the contrast with the red on there just
nice.
Gives it such a unique look and flavor to it. Like it's... It doesn't look like death metal. It doesn't really look like anything specific, which is actually a really good way of describing the album itself, right? Like it's rooted in death doom, but it kind of just does its own thing and just takes you wherever it wants to go. And the album cover does just that, right? Like, yeah, no, just awesome album.
Danny?
Let's see, how was I gonna start this final thought? How exactly was I going to start this final thought? Oh, okay.
With well, words.
With words, right.
I think the kernel got to his brain.
Shut up. Shut it.
It made its way up there. You have to sneeze it out.
Damn Daniel!
Damn Daniel! Okay. I think I was going to say, when people ask, like, what's your favorite Doom album? What's your favorite thing? I can't ever think of what my favorites are. But I think as far as Death Doom or just Doom metal in general, which I'm not totally huge on. I like some of that stuff. But a lot of it is boring, like Fred said. But my favorite probably would be this Castle album. And I think the people that listen to this show are people that are more open-minded to weird stuff, because that's not like our total thing. It's not like, oh, we just cover weird albums like Radical Research or something. But a lot of the weird ones and the like eccentric ones just happen to be kind of weird, and so I think everybody who listens to this show would get something out of this
if they haven't already.
Yeah,
right, and they probably have. I think most underground metal people know this one, and if they haven't listened to it in a while, they know. I feel like this is a thing too, where like you know an album's good, but you don't exactly remember what it sounds like. You just kind of trust your, oh yeah, that one's cool. I haven't heard it in a while, but it's cool.
Yeah, that's where I came from listening to this.
Yeah,
I hadn't listened to this like better part of like 10 years.
I don't know when the last time I listened to this was. I remember their standout parts, but going through it again this last week and just right now with you guys. Yeah, I'm totally in awe, and not only am I not bored, I'm fascinated by these riffs and by just about every aspect of this band and this album. It's I really really like it. I think I understand why certain metal people wouldn't like this. I feel like this is for the metal people that like 70s prog rock. If you don't like 70s prog rock, you probably won't like this. And I was always confused by that. I've heard that like some metal guys don't like that stuff, and I'm like,
I don't I don't think that's fair to say, though, because, like, I'm not huge into 70s prog. But this just works so well in the context of a Death Doom frame. Like, they pull that influence out without belaboring it.
Yeah, there is going to be a part two to that statement. I think the part two was, this isn't... I don't imagine that guys who are into a Sphix or into just, like heavy fucking either war metal or funeral doom or something like that. I feel like this would be kind of a turnoff to a lot of people, but I feel like those people are probably just not listening correctly, or there's something wrong with them.
Yeah, they can be wrong.
They can't. They can't. I mean, they can be, but yeah, they're just wrong. They can't be wrong. You're not gonna be wrong.
They shouldn't be.
I'll see to that. They shouldn't be. You should be right. Like Michelle Obama and Oprah Winfrey said, be better, be better.
Can we also just appreciate that this is yet another example of an album that has a self-titled track on the self-titled album?
Yep.
Awesome.
Castle, like Angel by Witch Castle, Angel on Witch, Castle.
Angel Witch. Yeah, Castle, yeah. Castle, Castle.
And Black Sabbath, Black Sabbath, Black Sabbath.
And I feel good. I finally got that out of the way. That was like weighing heavy on my heart that I hadn't done a doom metal pick yet. Finally did it, and I have to say, I'm not unhappy about it at all. I'm not even remotely like, that was okay. I was nah. How fucking kicks your tits in the dirt.
Yeah,
that's a new term that I've never heard before.
Kicks your tits in the dirt.
Dan's gonna be able to sleep tonight. That's good.
And you guys,
I always sleep. I never had a problem sleeping.
you can pick.
Whatever. I got lots of problems, but sleeping ain't one of them.
You can pick whatever your heart desires now.
Yeah, yeah. Don't have that looming over me.
Well, who wants to take us out?
Somebody say something.
Okay, I got this.
Something funny.
No, I set myself up, man. Nope, I got nothing.
He breathed.
There you go.